Chapter 18 and 19, how Hemad Pant was accepted and blessed. Stories of Mr. Sathe and Mrs. Deshmukh, encouraging good thoughts to fruition. Variety of Upadesh, teachings regarding slander and remuneration for labor. In the last two chapters, Hemad Pant describes how a rich gentleman aspiring for quick Brahma Gnan was treated by Baba. And now in these two chapters, he describes how Hemad Pant himself was accepted and blessed by Baba, how Baba encouraged good thoughts and fructified them, and his teachings regarding self-improvement, slander and remuneration for labor. Preliminary. It is a well-known fact that Sadhguru looks first to the qualification of his disciple and then gives them suitable instructions without unsetting their minds in the least, and leads them on towards the goal of self-realization. In this respect, some say that what the Sadhguru teaches or instructs should not be divulged to others. They think that their instructions become useless if they are published. This view is not correct. The Sadhguru is like a monsoon cloud. He pours down profusely, that is, scatters widely his nectar-like teachings. These we should enjoy and assimilate into our heart's content and then serve others with them without any reservation. This rule should apply not only to what he teaches in our waking state, but also to the visions he gives us in our dreams. To quote an instance, Buddha Kaushika Rishi published his celebrated Ramraksha Stotra, which he had seen in his dream. Like a loving mother forcing bitter but beneficial medicines down the throats of her children for the sake of their health, Sai Baba imparted spiritual instructions to his devotees. His method was not veiled or secret, but quite open. The devotees who followed his instructions got their object. Sadhguru like Sai Baba open our eyes, intellect, and show us the divine beauty of the self and fulfill our tender longings of devotion. When this is done, our desire for sense objects vanishes. Twin fruits of viveka, that is, discrimination and vairagya, come to our hands and knowledge sprouts up even in the sleep. All this we get when we come in contact with the saints, serve them and secure their love. The Lord who fulfills the desires of his devotees come to our aid, removes our troubles and sufferings and make us happy. The progress of development is entirely due to the help of the Sadhguru, who is regarded as the Lord himself. Therefore, we should always be after the Sadhguru, hear his stories, fall at his feet and serve him. Now we come to our main story. Mr. Sathe. There was a gentleman named Mr. Sathe who had attained some publicity many years ago during Crawford regime, which was put down by Lord Rae, the governor of Mumbai. He suffered severe losses in trade. Other adverse circumstances gave him much trouble and made him sad and dejected. Being restless, he thought of leaving home and going out to the distant place. Man does not generally think of God, but when difficulties and calamities overtake him, he turns to him and prays for relief. If his demerits have come to an end, God arranges his meetings with a saint who gives up proper directions regarding his welfare. Mr. Sathe had similar experience. His friends advised him to go to Shirdi, where so many people were flocking to get Sai Baba's darshan for getting peace of mind and the satisfaction of their wants. He liked the idea and at once came to Shirdi in 1917, seeing Baba's form, which was like eternal Brahma, self-luminous, peerless and pure. His mind lost in restlessness and became calm and composed. He thought that it was the accumulation of merits of his former births that brought him to the holy feet of Baba. He was a man of strong will. He at once started to make a parayan of Guru Charitra. When the reading was finished in the Sapta, Baba gave him a vision that night. It was to this effect. Baba, with Guru Charitra in his hand, was explaining its contents to Mr. Sathe, who was sitting in front and listening carefully. When he woke up, he remembered the dream and he felt very happy. He thought that it was extremely kind of Baba, who awakens a soul like his that are snoring and in ignorance and makes them taste the nectar of Guru Charitra. Next day, he informed Kaka Sahib Dikshit of his vision and requested him to consult Sri Sai Baba regarding its meaning or significance, whether one sapta reading was sufficient or whether he should begin again. Kaka Sahib Dikshit, when got a suitable opportunity, asked Baba, "Deva, what did you suggest to Mr. Sathe by this vision? Whether he should stop or continue the sapta? He is a simple devotee. His desire should be fulfilled." Then Baba replied, "He should make one more sapta of the book. If the work be studied carefully, the devotee will become pure and will be benefited. The Lord will be pleased and will rescue him from the bondage of the mundane existence." At this time, Hemadpant was present there. He was shampooing Baba's legs. When he heard Baba's words, he thought in his mind, "What, Mr. Sathe read the book, read for a week only and got a reward, and I am reading it for 40 years with no result. His 7 days stay here became fruitful, while my 7 years stay, 1910 to 1917, goes for nothing. Like a Chataka bird, I am ever waiting for the merciful cloud to pour his nectar on me and bless me with his instructions." No sooner did this thought came across his mind, Baba knew it, and then and there. It was the experience of Bhaktas that Baba understood all their thoughts, and that he suppressed the evil thoughts and encouraged the good ones. Reading Hemad's mind, Baba at once asked him to get up and go to Shama and get from him rupees 15 as Dakshina, sit and chit-chat with him for a while and then return. Mercy dawned in Baba's mind, and so he issued this order. And who could disobey Baba's order? Hemadpant immediately left the masjid and came to Shama's house. He had just bathed and was wearing a dhotar. He came out and asked Hemadpant, "How is it that you are here now? It seems that you have come from the masjid. Why do you look restless and dejected? Why are you alone? Please sit and rest while I shall do my workshop. I shall do my worship and return. In the meanwhile, you please take pan bida, leaves from betel nuts, etc. Let us then have a pleasant chat." After saying this, he went inside and Hemadpant sat alone in the veranda. He saw in the window a well-known Marathi book named Nath Bhagavat. This is a commentary by the saint Ekanath on the 11th skanda of the biggest Sanskrit work, the Bhagavat. At the suggestion or recommendations of Sai Baba, Mrs. Babu Sahib Jog and Kaka Sahib Dikshit read Bhagavat daily with its Marathi commentary named Bhavarth Deepika or Gnaneshwari, a dialogue between Krishna and between Krishna and his servant devotee Uddhava, and also Eknath's other big work, that is Bhavartha Ramayana. When devotees came to Baba and asked him certain questions, he sometimes answered them in part and asked them to go and listen to the readings of the above mentioned works, which are the main treatise of Bhagavat Dharma. When the devotees went and listened, they got full satisfaction, replies to their questions. Hemadpant also used to read daily some portion of the Nath Bhagavat. That day he did not complete the daily portion of his reading, but had left it unfinished in order to accompany certain devotees who were going to the masjid. When he looked up at the book from Shama's window and casually opened it, he found to his surprise that the unfulfilled portion had opened up. He thought that Baba sent him very kindly to Shama's house for enabling him to complete his daily reading. So he went through the unfinished portion and completed it. As soon as this was over, Shama, after doing his worship, came out, and following conversation took place between them. Hemadpant, "I have come with a message from Baba. He has asked me to return with rupees 15 as Dakshina from you. Also to sit and chat with you for a while or have a pleasant chit-chat and then return to the masjid with you." Shama with surprise, "I have no money to give. take my 15 namaskars in lieu of rupees to as dakshina to Baba. Hey Madhupant, all right, your namaskars are accepted. Now let us have some chit chat. Tell me some stories of, and leelas of Baba which will destroy our sins. Shama, then sit here for a while. Wonderful is the sport of this god Baba. You know it already. I am a village rustic while you are an enlightened citizen. You have seen more leelas since you are coming over here. How should I describe them before you? Well, take these leaves, betel nut and chuna, and have the pan beda while I go in and dress myself and come out. In a few minutes, Shama came out and sat talking with Hemad Pant. He said, "Leela of this god is inscrutable. There is no end to his leelas. Who can see them? He plays or sports with his leelas. Still he is obeyed, unaffected by them. What do we restrict? No. Why does not Baba himself tell stories? Why does he send learned men like you to fools like me? His ways are inconceivable. I can only say that they are not human." With this preface, Shama added, "I now remember a story which I shall relate to you. I know it personally. As a devotee is resolute and determined, so is Baba's immediate response. Sometimes Baba puts that devotee to severe test and then gives them upadesh." As soon as Hemad Pant heard the word upadesh, a flash of lightning crossed through his mind. He at once remembered the story of Mr. Sate's Guru Charitra reading and thought that Baba might have sent him to Shama in order to give peace to his restless mind. However, he curbed his feeling and began to listen to Shama's stories. They all showed how kind and affectionate Baba was to his devotees. Hemad Pant began to feel joy on hearing all this. Then Shama began to tell the following story. Mrs. Radhabai Deshmukh. There was an old woman by name Radhabai. She was the mother of one Khashaba Deshmukh. Hearing Baba's fame, she had come to Shirdi with the people of Sangamner. She took Baba's darshan and was much satisfied. She loved Baba intimately and resolved in her mind that she should accept Baba as her guru and take some upadesh from him. She determined to fast herself unto death so long as Baba did not accept her and give her any upadesh or mantra. She stayed in her lodging and stopped taking food or water for 3 days. I was frightened by the ordeal of the old woman and interceded with Baba on her behalf. I said, "Deva, what is this you have started? You drag so many people here. You know that old lady. She is very obstinate and depends on you. She has resolved to fast unto death. If you don't accept and instruct her, if anything worse happens, people will blame you and say that Baba did not instruct her as a consequence. She met her death, so take some mercy on her, bless her and instruct her." On seeing her determination, Baba sent for her and made her change her mind by addressing as follows. "O mother, why do you have to subject yourself to unnecessary tortures? You are my mother and I am your child. Take pity on me and hear me through. I tell you my own story, which if you listen carefully, will do you good. I had a guru. He was a great saint and most merciful. I served him long, very long. Still he would not blow any mantra into my ears. I had been keen desire never to leave him, but to stay with him, serve him, and at all costs receive some instructions from him. But he had his own way. He first got my head shaved and asked me for 2 paise as dakshina. I gave him the same at once. You may say that as guru was perfect, why should he ask for money? And now should he be called desireless? The reply is that he never cared for coins. What he had asked, but what had he to do with them? The 2 paisas were firm faith and patience and perseverance. I gave the 2 paise to him and he was pleased. I resorted to my guru for 12 years. He brought me up. There was no death, no dearth of food or clothing. He was full of love, or say he was love incarnate. How can I describe it? He loved me most. Rare is a guru like him. When I looked at him, he seemed as if he was in deep meditation, and then we both were filled with bliss. Night and day I gazed at him with no thought of hunger and thirst. Without him I felt restless. I had no other subject to meditate upon, nor any other thing than my guru to attend. He was my sole refuge. My mind was always fixed on him. This nishtha is 1 paisa of dakshina. Saburi, patience or perseverance, is the other paisa. I waited patiently and served my guru. This saburi will ferry you across the sea of this mundane existence. Saburi removes all the sins and afflictions, gets rid of calamities in various ways, and casts aside all fears, and ultimately gives you success. Saburi is the mine of virtues, consort of good thought. Nishtha, faith, and saburi, patience, are like twin sisters, loving each other very intimately. My guru never expected any other thing from me. He never neglected me, but protected me at all times. I lived with him and was at sometimes away from him. Still, I never felt the absence of his love. He always protected me by his glance. Just as the tortoise feeds her young ones, whether they are near or they are away from her on the other side of the bank, by her loving glances. O mother, my guru never taught me any mantra. Then how shall I blow any mantra in your ears? Just remember that guru's tortoise like a loving glance gives us happiness. Do not try to get mantra or upadesh from anybody. Make me the sole object of your thoughts and actions, and you will no doubt attain Paramatma. Look at me wholeheartedly, and I am in turn look at you. Sitting in the masjid, I speak the truth, nothing but the truth. No sadhana or proficiency in the 6 shastras is necessary. Have faith and confidence in your guru. Believe that guru is the sole actor or doer. Blessed is he who knows the greatness of his guru and thinks him to be Hari, Hara, and Brahma incarnate. Instructed in this way, the old lady was convinced. She bowed to Baba and gave up her past. Hearing this story carefully and attentively, and making its significance and appropriateness, Hemadpant was almost most agreeably surprised. On seeing this wonderful leela of Baba, he was moved from top to toe. He was overwhelming with joy. His throat was choked, and he was not able to utter a single word. Shama, on seeing him in this condition, asked him, "What's the matter with you? Why are you silent? How shall I describe the innumerable leelas of Baba?" Just at this time, the bell of the masjid began to ring, proclaiming that the noon worship and aarti ceremony had begun. Therefore, Shama and Hemadpant hurried to the masjid. Bapu Sahib Jog had just started the worship. Women were up in the masjid and men were standing below in the open courtyard. And they were all singing the aarti in chorus to the accompaniments of drums. Shama went up, pulling the Hemadpant with him. He sat to the right and Hemadpant in front of Baba. On seeing them, Baba asked Hemadpant to give dakshina brought from Shama. He replied that Shama gave namaskars in lieu with 2 rupees and that he was there in person. Baba said, "All right, now let me know whether you both had a chit-chat, and if so, tell me all that you talked about." Not minding the sounds of the bell and drum and the chorus songs, Hemadpant was eager to tell Baba what they all had talked about and started to narrate it. Baba was also anxious to hear, and so he left the bolster and leaned forward. Hemadpant said all that they had talked about was very pleasant, especially the story of the old lady was almost wonderful, and that on hearing it, he thought that his leela was inexplicable and under the guise of that story. He really blessed him. Baba then said, "Wonderful is the story. How were you blessed? I would like to know everything in detail from you. So tell me about it." Then Hemadpant related in full the story which he had heard a little while before and had made a lasting impression on his mind. Hearing this, Baba was much pleased and asked him, Did the story strike you and did you catch its significance? He replied, Yes, Baba, the restlessness of my mind has vanished and I have true peace and rest and now and came to know about the true path. Then Baba spoke as follows, My method is quite unique. Remember well this one story and it will be very useful to get the knowledge of the self. Dhyana is necessary. If you practice it continuously, the vrittis will be practiced. Being quite desireless, you should meditate on God who is in all the creatures, and when the mind is concentrated, the goal will be achieved. Meditate always on my formless nature, which is acknowledged, incarnate, consciousness and bliss. If you cannot do this, meditate on my form from top to toe. As you see here, right and night and day, as you go on doing this, your vrittis will be a single pointed, and the distinction between the dhyana and dhyan, dhyata and dhyan, dhyaya will be lost. Dhyata is meditator, dhyana act of meditation, and dhyaya is thing which is on which meditated upon will be lost. And the meditator will be one with the consciousness and be merged in the Brahma. The mother tortoise is on one bank of the river and her young ones are on the other. She gives neither milk nor warm to them. Her mere loving glances give them nutrition. The young ones do not do nothing but remember their mother. The tortoise glances to the young ones, the only source of sustenances and happiness. Similar is the relation between the guru and disciple. When Baba uttered these words, the chorus of the Aarti song was over and all cried out very loudly in unison, Victory be to our Sadguru Sai Maharaj, who is pure consciousness, knowledge and bliss. Dear readers, let us imagine that we are at this time standing amongst the crowd in the masjid, and let us join them in this Jai Jaikar. After the Aarti ceremony was over, Prasad was distributed. Bapu Sahib Jog came forward as usual and after saluting Baba, gave into his palm a handful of sugar candy. Baba pushed all this into the hands of Hemad Pant and said to him, If you take this story to heart and remember it well, your state will be as sweet as the sugar candy. All your wishes will be fulfilled and you will be happy. Hemad Pant bowed down to Baba and implored, Do favors like this to me. Bless and protect me always. Baba replied, Hear this story, meditate on it and assimilate its spirit. Then you will always remember and meditate on the Lord who will manifest himself to you. Dear readers, Hemad Pant got prasad of sugar candy and we now get the prasad of sugar candy of or nectar of this story. Let us drink it to our heart's content, meditate on it and assimilate it and be strong and happy by Baba's grace. Amen. Towards the end of the 19th chapter, Hemad Pant had dealt with other matters which are given below. Baba's advice regarding our behavior. The following words of Baba are of general welfare and invaluable. If they are kept in mind and accepted and acted upon, they will always do you good. Unless there is some relationship or connection, nobody goes anywhere. If any man or creatures come to you, do not discourteously drive them out, but receive them well and treat them with due respect. Sri Hari will be certainly pleased. If you give water to the thirsty, bread to the hungry, clothes to the naked, and your veranda to strangers for resting, if anybody wants some money from you and you are not inclined to give, do not give, but do not bark at them like a dog. Let anybody speak hundreds of things against you, do not resent by giving them bitter reply. If you tolerate such things, you will certainly be happy. Let Let the world go topsy-turvy. You remain where you are. Standing in your own place, look on calmly at the show, all the things passing before you. Demolish the wall of difference that separates you from me, and then the road for our meeting will be clear and open. The sense of differentiation as I and thou is the barrier that keeps away the disciple from the master, and unless that is destroyed, the state of union is not possible. Allah Malik, that is, God, is the sole proprietor. Nobody else is our protector. His method of work is extraordinary, invaluable, and inscrutable. His will is done, and He will show us the way and satisfy our heart desires. It is on account of Rabindranath. It is on account of Runanubandha that we have come together. Let us love and serve each other and be happy. He who attains the supreme goal of life is immortal and happy. All others merely exist, that is, live so long as they breathe. Encouraging good thoughts to fruition. It is interesting to note that Sai Baba encouraged good thoughts. You have to surrender yourself completely to Him with love and devotion, and then you will see how He helps you throughout. Some saint has said that when you get a good thought immediately after awakening from sleep, and if you develop the same afterwards during the day, your intellect will be unfolded and your mind will attain calmness. Hemadpant wanted to try this. One Wednesday night, before going to bed, he thought, tomorrow is Thursday, an auspicious day, and the place that is Shirdi is so holy. So let me pass the whole day in remembering and celebrating Ramanam. And then he slept off. Next morning when he got up, he remembered without any effort the name of Ram was the name of Ram, and was much pleased. After finishing his morning duties, he went to see Baba with flowers. When he left Dikshitwada and was passing the Bootiwada, the present Samadhi Mandir, he heard a beautiful song that was being sung nicely by an Aurangabadkar in the masjid before Baba. The song was Guru Krupa Anjana Payo Mere Bhai by Eknath, in which he says that he got collyrium in the form of his guru grace, which opened his vision and made him see Ram in and out in sleep, dream, and waking state, and everywhere. There were so many songs, but why was this song particularly chosen by Aurangabadkar, a devotee of Baba? Is this not a curious coincidence arranged by Baba to amplify the determination of Hemadpant to sing unceasingly Ramanam during the day? All saints agree and lay stress upon the efficacy of uttering Ram's name in fulfilling the ambitions of the bhaktas and in protecting and saving them from all calamities. Variety in Upadesh, slander condemned. Sai Baba required no special place nor any special time for giving instructions. Whenever any occasion demanded, he gave them freely. When it so happened that a bhakta of Baba reviled someone behind his back before other people, on leaving aside merits, he dwelt upon the faults of his brother and spoke sarcastically that the hearers were disgusted. Generally, we see that people have a tendency to scandalize others unnecessarily, and this brings all ill feelings. Saints see scandal in another light. They say that there are various ways of cleaning or removing the dirt, that is, by means of water and soap, etc. But the scandal monger has got a way of his own. He removes the dirt, the others by his tongue. So in a way, he obliges the person whom he reviles for this. He is to be thanked. Sai Baba had his own method of correcting the scandal monger. He knew by his omniscience that the slander had what the slanderer had done when he met him at noon near the landing. Baba pointed out to him a pig that was eating filth near the fence and said to him, "Behold, how with what relish it is gulping filth. Your conduct is similar. You go on reviling your own brother to your heart's content. After performing many deeds of merit, you are born as a human. And if you act like this, how can Shirdi help you in any way?" Needless to say that the Bhakta took the lesson to his heart and went away. In this way, Baba went on giving instructions whenever necessary. If those who are born in our minds and acted upon, the spiritual goal, that is realization, is not far off. There is a proverb which says, "If there be my Hari, he will feed me on my cot." This proverb is only true in respect of food and clothing. But if anyone believing this sits idle and does nothing in spiritual matters, he will be ruined. One has to exert himself to his utmost for attaining self-realization. The more he endeavors, the better for him. Baba said that he was omnipresent, transcending land, air, world, light and heaven, and that he was not localized. To remove the misunderstanding of those who thought that Baba was only his body, three cubits and a half in length, he incarnated himself on his form, and if any devotee meditated upon him day and night with complete self-surrender, he experienced a complete union with him, like sweetness and sugar, waves and sea, ice and sight. He who wants to get rid of the cycle of births and deaths should read the righteous life with his mind calm and composed. He should not speak harshly to anyone so as to hurt him. He should always engage himself in a good action, should do his duties and surrender himself, heart and soul, to him. He need not be afraid of anything. He who trusts him entirely, hears and expounds like his leelas, and does not think anything else, is sure to attain self-realization. Baba asked many to remember his name and to surrender to him, but to those who wanted to know who they were, "Who am I?" He advised Shravana and Manana. To some, he advised remembering God's name. To others, hearing his leelas. To some, worship his feet. To others, reading and studying Adhyatma Ramayana, Jnaneshwari and other sacred scriptures. Some he made sit near his feet, some he sent to Khandoba temple, and for some he advised the repetition of the 1000 names of Vishnu, and some the study of Chandogya Upanishad and Gita. There was neither any limit nor any restriction to his instructions. He gave in person or by visions and dreams. To someone addicted to drink, he appeared in his dream, sat on his chest, pressed it, and left him after he gave his promise not to touch liquor anymore. To some, he explained some mantras like Guru Brahma in dreams. To some devotees, he would practice Hatha Yoga. He sent word that he should leave the Hatha Yoga practices, sit quietly, wait. It is impossible to describe all his ways and methods in ordinary worldly dealings. He was examples by his action, one of which is given below. Remuneration for labor. One day at noon, Baba came near Radha Krishnamai's house and said, "Bring me a ladder." Some men brought it and set it against the wall of the house. As directed by Baba, he climbed up on the roof of Vaman Gondakar's house, passed over the roof of Radha Krishnamai's house, and then got down from the other corner. What object Baba had, none of them knew. Radha Krishnamayi was at that time shivering with malaria. It was to drive off that fever, that he may have gone up there. Immediately after getting down, Baba paid 2 rupees to the persons who brought the ladder. Somebody asked him, "Why are you paying so much for this?" He replied that nobody should take the labor of others in vain. The worker should be paid his dues promptly and liberally. If the principle taught by Baba is followed, that is, if the remuneration for labor be paid promptly and satisfactorily, the laborers will turn out better, and both the laborers and the employers will be profited. Bo to Sri Sai, peace be to all.